Will invite Shri Prakash Javrekar ji, the Honorable Minister for Human Resource Development, and greetings also to all the dignitaries. May I request all our speakers of the valedictory session to please join us on the stage, please. Mr. Brian McElduff, the Honorable Ambassador Ireland, joining us. Mr. Frank Laviu. And welcome to all of you to the valedictory session, the concluding session, which in a way to take it forward. Our special thanks once again to the chair of ILN, ladies and gentlemen, because of his very aggressive efforts which the Honorable Minister has been taking. His ministry has recently also been conferred with the Web Ratna Digital India Award 2016. And this is an award given to a government entity for having taken e-gov initiative. Our greetings to our Honorable Minister of State for Electronics and Energy and Law. Shri P.P. Chaudh White here, Mr. Trilok Chandra, Director, Meti. Our greetings to respected Secretary, Ms. Aruna Sundarajan, and I would like to invite here Ms. Uma Chauhan, Director Meti, to please accord a floral welcome to respected Secretary, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. And we're really delighted, ladies and gentlemen, to have His Excellency Mr. Brian McElduff, the Honorable Ambassador of Ireland. He is here with us to make a very important announcement. I don't want to steal the thunder, so I leave it here. But welcome to you, sir. And I would like to request and invite Mr. Dipinder Singh, the ISGAV Communications Chair, ISGAV India Communication Chair, to please welcome him. Our greetings to Ms. Tomas Sorovsky, joining us, the ISGAV series coordinator, and I would like to invite here Mr. DVL N. Rao.
Thank you.
after a rigorous review process, there were 132 which were selected, and these have been considered for the awards. And today, right now, we are going to be having three in each category. The awards are going to be presented. So to let you know more about these awards, the evaluation process, the strategy which was adopted, the selection process, and also to announce the winners here, I would like to invite Ms. Elsa Estevez, the ISGAV Steering Committee Chair. And I, from here, hand it over to her to announce the winners and to talk to us more about the awards. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. This place is better because here I have the computer so I can read. So the first thing, I would like to invite the committee members that helped me for the Best Paper Awards. So the committee was integrated by the PC chairs. So I would like to invite Tomasz Janowski. I would like to invite Raul De. And I would like to invite Rehima Baguma to help me in handling the awards. Rehima? Welcome. Yes. They will bring you. The Best Papers Awards include three categories: for the best research paper, the best experience paper, and the best poster paper. The criteria for selecting the papers include looking at the relevance of the paper, the novelty of the topic that is addressed, the contribution, either from the point of view of the theory or from the practice. So here are the nominations for the best research papers, which include relevance of participatory approaches in creating ICT systems for public health programs, authored by Priyanka Ivaturi, Angel Gina, Amit Prakash, from the International Institute of Information Technology, Bangalore, India. Usage practices and user types of a municipal Wi-Fi network, the case of Wi-Fi Lugano, by Anna Pico Schwendener, H. Jost Reinhold, and Lorenzo Cantoni, from Università della Svizzera Italiana, Lugano, Switzerland. Third paper is application of GIS and space-time scan statistics for vector-borne disease clustering by Mahe. And the fourth paper is potential of language technology to support public organizations and their communication channels in a developing country by Eric Snyders, Jean-Claude Biungura, Martin Henkel, and Eric Perjons from the Department of Computer and System Science from Stockholm University in Sweden. So after selecting these four papers, we concluded that the Best Paper Awards goes for, and I would like the authors please to join us here in the podium, Usage Practices and User Types of a Municipal Wi-Fi Network, the case of Wi-Fi Lugano, by Anna Pico Schwendener, A. Jost Reinhold, and Lorenzo Cantoni. So the next category is about the best experience paper. And here, oh surprise, we have three Indian papers. And this is also related to the statistics because there were really a lot of very good Indian papers submitted and accepted for this edition of the conference. So the three papers include Enterprise Architecture for E-Government by Reshma Agarwal, Vinay Thakur, and Radha Chauhan from NEGD India. Using administrative data for monitoring and improving land policy and governance in India by Pranab Ranjan Chaudhuri, Manoj Kumar Behira from Center for Land Governance, NRMC, Bhubaneswar, India. And e-transformation in Indian telecom sector through M-Governance by Rakesh Gupta, Inderpal Singh Sethi, Vivek Gupta, Ashutosh Prasad Maurya, Ramya Rahamanikam from NIC, Delhi, India. And from the three of them, the winner is using administrative data for monitoring and improving land policy and governance in India, Pranab Rajan Chaudhuri, Manoj Kumar Behira from the Center for Land Governance, Bhubaneswar, India. E-tendering solution with e-payment integration from the state of Goa, Milev Fal Desai, Gaurav Naik from Infotech Corporation of Goa Limited, Panaji, Goa, India, and Antares Systems Limited, Bangalore, India. And leveraging information and communication technologies in public distribution systems, EPDS, by Amit Pal, Wipro, Rajasthan, India, and Rajit Deep Pal from DOIT and C, Rajasthan, India. So the winner in this category is e-governance transaction aggregation, analysis and reconciliation through ITAL from Deepak Chandra Misra, Inderpal Singh Sethi, and Om Gupta. So I would like to ask you to please join me congratulating very much to all authors of all nominated papers. I have one more job because there was students that I will be naming. The first student is the award for the first position. Abhishek Singhal will receive a cash prize of 20,000 rupees. So please join me and congratulate him. The award for the second position goes for Suchi Mala and receiving a cash prize of 15,000 rupees. Is for Atishai Jain, receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees. The awards for the location analyst enthusiast goes to Harsh Aditya Singh, receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees. The awards for the big data analyst goes to Jasleen Kaur and receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees. The awards for the mobile tech innovator goes to Naveen Kumar Satsivam, receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees. The award for IoT Wizard is for Malini PJ, receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees. The awards for BI Mogul is for Sadvik Bhatnagar, receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees. And the awards for AI Wizard is for Varun Gupta, receiving a cash prize of 5,000 rupees.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you can imagine, a lot went into organizing this conference, but in the interest of time, I'm just going to share with you a tiny sneak peek about what the organization started in July 2016 with weekly meetings over Skype, connecting organizers over three, sometimes four continents. Each paper was reviewed by a minimum of three reviewers from a big pool of ICE-Gov, PC, program committee, from a big pool of ICE-Gov program committee members who are top academics in different universities and research institutes around the world. After the review process, selection of the 132 papers out of the 560 papers took over 8 hours on a marathon Skype session. Other than the weekly Skype meetings, all the other organizational activities of the conference were also done online via Skype, using emails, using the EasyChair conference management system, and later on WhatsApp. Thank you very much. Shukriya.
I have to confess, I wish when I came here, I could have split my personality into Rahul A, Rahul B, and Rahul C, so that I could be in A, B, and C halls simultaneously. Sadly, I couldn't do that, so my impressions are based on only the one or two halls, one hall I could be on in most cases. I will comment on some of the key themes that resonated across the conference. We had a wide diversity of papers, very wide. One of the themes that came through was the whole issue of co-design and participatory government, which was initially mentioned by one of the keynote speakers. Another one was the nature of change and transformation and the collaboration that is needed for this. Again, this was resonated across papers and by keynote speakers and the plenary speakers. The importance of the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, and their role in future of digital government priorities across the world received a lot of attention and a lot of discussion. ICTs have to focus on the marginal and the poor. This was, again, a coherent theme that ran across the conference. Upliftment was an explicit and an implicit goal in many of the papers that I could listen to. I should mention that there was very strong participation in all tracks and sessions. Sometimes the comments and questions from the audience drew as much attention and applause as the presenters. That's great news for the audience. Thank you for the presentation.
Better conditions for development, whatever development means in different national, local, or sectoral circumstances. But while powerful, the use of digital technology by itself does not automatically and sustainably translate into development outcomes. Neither we can entirely trust the public sector with this task. We need institutions which mission is to create public value and serve public interest, and empower these institutions with digital tools and digital capabilities. Arguably, the main achievement of ISGOV was to build this community, extending across 103 countries of the world and across sectoral, development, cultural, and other boundaries. Another grand achievement is the 10th edition of ISGOV, so the organization of ISGOV 2017 in New Delhi, which really exceeded by far my expectations, but also renewed and reconfirmed the focus on development that we pursued with the ISGOV since the start of the series in 2007. Actually, today's session about community service centers, attended by young poor girls who are CSC instructors spreading digital empowerment throughout the country, and the presence of the Honorable Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad at the session were both touching and symbolic. I would like here to express on behalf of the ISGOV series and the ISGOV community our deepest thanks and appreciation to the Honorable Minister, to Srimati Secretary Aruna Sundarayan, to Srimati Radha Chauhan, and the entire team from Digital India for making possible this world-class conference and for truly wonderful hospitality. Please join me in expressing thanks. I would also like to share that I will be stepping down from my role as ISGOV series coordinator after the conference. I would like to, 10 years is a long time. I would like to thank colleagues and community members for sharing and supporting this project over 10 years. So the role will be replaced functionally by the chair of the steering committee with support from the ISGOV secretariat, and the announcement about this change will be done by Professor Luis Barbosa, who is the acting head of UNU EGOV as the institutional owner of the ISGOV series. Thank you very much.
Taking the views and organizing. Luis Suarez Barbosa for his views.
Honorable ministers, secretaries, distinguished guests, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the United Nations University and of its Operational Unit on Policy-Driven Electronic Governance, located in Portugal, I want to express our deepest gratitude to the government of that. I'm particularly grateful for their effort to make each of us feel at home through a powerful but very smooth and discreet organization. In ICT, we used to say that this does not happen by chance, but by intelligent design and a lot of work. Thank you so much. I can't think of a better way to celebrate the 10th anniversary of ISGOV, this very special conference. Over time, ISGOV became a landmark event in the area, touching different communities and a huge and heterogeneous network. University and the ISGOV community owe him. We are proud. You may remember Alice in Wonderland. Here, please, your that depends a great deal on where you want to get to. This is the challenge for our community. What I can assure you is that the full commitment and the continuous support of the United Nations University of this extraordinary series of conferences, which remains as strong as ever, as one of our flagship projects in UNU EGOV. I also would like to thank the organizers of next ISGOV. I think I shall not reveal the names so far. Okay, not yet. Not a simple job, I'm afraid, after India, but congratulations and thank you. Finally, and on a more personal note, let me share how inspiring it was for me to celebrate the ISGOV anniversary in India, a country with a millennial tradition of public discussion and interactive reasoning, which is so closely related to the very roots of democracy. Along these days, I recalled the council summit by Emperor Ashoka in the 3rd century before the Christian era, which were probably the earliest open general meetings in the world, and the later Empress Akbar's sponsorship and support for dialogue between different faiths, based on the thesis that the judgment of reason rather than reliance on tradition is the way to address difficult problems in social harmony, the way to reinvent the state and government and governments, maybe we'll say so now. Public reasoning is central to participatory governance, and this is part of the heritage of this great country that makes India such an inspiring democracy in these difficult times we are living. It was a real privilege to have ISGOV 10th anniversary in India. And now I would like to announce that yesterday the steering committee has a meeting, and by a unanimous vote we have chosen the chair of the steering committee for the next 3 years, our very nice, very esteemed colleague, Elsa Esteves, and I call her to the stage.
First of all, I would like to thank the steering committee for the trust they are putting on me, and I hope and I promise I will work hard to fulfill the responsibilities of the job. I know that to fill Thomas' shoes, as many times I said, is very difficult, but please be assured that I will do my best, and because as we conclude during all 3 days, this is not something that one person can do. This is a community work, as Thomas was mentioning. So I fully rely on the members of the steering committee, but also in all members of the community, and also in all institutions that have been involved during all these 10 years of ISGOV, to work together to jointly strengthen our community, grow our community, to be the think tank that all governments around the world need for having a better, safe, and inclusive societies. Thank you for the trust. And I also would like to acknowledge that as a former fellow, former student of Tomasz, I hope that all the learnings I received from him I would be able to implement on the future path ahead. Thank you very much. And I would like to use this time, 2 more minutes, because I would like to call Marijn Jansen, because as a community, we have some message to deliver today. And this will be done by Marijn, one of our distinguished members.
I think the name ISGOV series coordinator is the wrong name. I think intelligent designer is already better. Maybe community creator is already better. But what Thomas is of course the father and the founder of 10 years of ISGOV series. And I hope he will become also the grandfather in the future. Wow. Show this. There you go, Thomas. On behalf of the community.
me.
Congratulations, Ms. Elza, and we are sure that ISGOV is going to be further benefiting from the many contributions which Mr. Tomas has been making to it. And thank you to Mr. Barbosa also for extending his appreciation, and as you assured us that your Alice was happy in this wonderland. Thank you. And now may I request Mr. Ayogi Shirogi, the Director of UNESCO, for his views and reflections.
Honorable Minister Shri Ravishankar Prasad, Shri Prakash Javadkar, Shri P.P. Chaudhary, Honorable Ambassador, the dignitaries on the dais and their participants. On behalf of UNESCO, I'd like to congratulate the organizer, the Government of India and the UNU for organizing and completing this very relevant and timely gathering to reflect on the e-governance. I'd like to extend our, on behalf of UNESCO, big congratulations to the participants, especially, who gave us a lot of thoughts and reflections on the future directions, especially around the, how the e-governance contribute, technology can contribute to the development of the sustainable development goals. The UNESCO has been working very closely with the e-gov community, and also the UNU and the government of the many countries. And then we think the innovation and the ICT is the must item for achieving the SDG goals. But at the same time, we need to look at the digital gap, which we discussed in the last session today. And in that sense, I really, really commend the initiative of India about the Digital India, which is just not only for the promoting the ICT, but it addresses the most needy people on the ground to reduce the digital gap. So I understand that the Indian government will pursue this very noble for the development of the democracy that refers to basically the participation of all citizens. And e-governance and this, the ISGOV, will give us some thought on how we can appeal and then develop the new model of democracy in the future. In that sense, I really congratulate the organizer, and then UNESCO is fully committed in pursuing the more collaboration in this endeavor. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Shikhar.
I wish to also take this opportunity to profusely thank all the stakeholders for making it possible through their wholehearted participation and support, especially Honorable Minister of Electronics and IT, Law and Justice, Sri Ravishankar Prasadji, for his inspiring and visionary leadership, Honorable Minister of Portugal and Conference Co-Chair, Ms. Maria Marques, for her scintillating inaugural and keynote address and gracing the various sessions. My distinguished senior colleagues in the Union Cabinet, Sri Prakash Javadekariji, for gracing the valedictory session. UNESCO and United Nations University, who are our partners in organizing this conference. The distinguished set of knew that across the for the conference, a huge round of applause for my entire mighty team, especially members from NEGD. Without whose selfless devotion and hard work, this conference could not have been such a grand success. Friends, throughout the conference, we witnessed keynote addresses and panel discussion that gave new insights on how digital government can lead to digital empowerment by incorporating local knowledge. During the conference, papers were presented on a wide array of topics such as usage of visual analysis and big data analytics, preserving solutions to tackle global issues from successful experiments done across the globe, and patterns for creation of open content in different nations. The incisive keynote lectures delivered by distinguished speakers during the conference covered the experience of e-governance in Portugal, linkages among the political expediencies and administrative performances, mediation through technology to boost public service delivery and creation of a better through series of insights. Presentations were countries as well to share their experience and practices of e-governance. I'm sure that the key insight generated from these sessions would be duly considered by various stakeholders, including my ministry, in future course of actions. Friends, we have witnessed a significant thrust on envisioning of a roadmap to attend the SDGs during the conference. However, while all SDGs are crucial for a better world for mankind, I would highlight three critical areas among them, namely health, education, and agriculture. The lack of quality support in these sectors is the major impediment restricting growth in underdeveloped and developing countries across the world. There is a need to urgently address the vicious cycle of low life expectancy, low education levels, and low farm productivity in these nations. Extensive use of technology, which in turn can significantly pace and French at the end. I thank you all once again for the wonderful and unflinching support for ICE 2017. I'm sure that our collective efforts will lead to the creation of knowledge society through ethical use of digital governance tools. This in turn will lead to the digital empowerment of citizens across the globe in truest sense, making the world a better place to live for the humanity and other living.
All the knowledge partners and United Nations and UNESCO's participation and all stakeholders and friends. I'm very happy to be here. We are celebrating Digital India and digital way of governance. And that's very important because I was just rewinding, I was IT task force chairman of Government of Maharashtra in the year 95 to 99. And in 96, just 21 years ago, we came out with our first e-governance property. The property registration was such a headache that time that you will get only the kaccha receipt and you will not get the final receipt for 20 years. When we brought this with the help of CDAC, this reduced everything, and now instant receipt, instant documentation, instant registration with photo, thumb impression and sign and everything. So that was the beginning of e-governance. Then during Atalji's time, I was heading working group on IT for masses in Government of India. And we thought of and took all states into confidence and made them come out with more and more e-government tools, e-governance tools. And I know very clearly, I recollect when ICTs were, ICT Seva Kendra, service centers were thought of and first centers were opened in Northeast, there was an issue of viability of that because there was nothing to offer from the Kendras. That was the problem that time. Applications are available on ICT Seva Kendra. Also saves cost. Now we have to make a digital governance movement a mass movement. And Ravi Shankar ji, let me tell you, and I can be partner because I have the young army of 40 million college and university students who are ready. We had launched digital financial literacy campaign after demonetization, and within 2 months, more than 4,30,000 students volunteered themselves to be the volunteers, digital cynics of the movement. As was envisioned by our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, digital mode of payment will come into reality only when we go to people and talk to them and train them. And we started training them. More than 20 lakh families have been converted by these students into digital mode, and more than 2 lakh shopkeepers have also learned the art of digital payment transactions. So, and we will continue this. Even now, in the summer vacation, our target is that we'll do much more work and go to the people again and converse and train them. And that's my force on ground, which we and IT ministry can work together. We have also taken one more thing. First time India is organizing smart hackathon. Smart hackathon is popular in many other countries, developed countries, but we are doing it, and I'm very happy. First time Indian ministries have given 600 plus problem statements to find out digital solutions for it. So we have problem statements, and more than 2,000 institutes, 42,000 students, 7,000 team. Each team consists of 6 students. So 7,000 teams are working. That means on each problem statement, there are 10 or 12 teams are working on it. And the best of the best digital solution, we will give them reward, and we will appreciate that because that can be brought into practice. So that's a major initiative we are taking. We are all, and we are doing many other things. Our Swayam, India's own MOOCs, the whole cloud network and everything is Indian, and it is available on all platforms, including mobile. And therefore, that's also a digital revolution in a different way. We know ATM, anytime money. But now with Swayam, it is anytime ATL, anytime learning, anywhere learning. So that's how we are coming with. More than 2,000 courses will be offered to the in-students as well as anybody, any citizen of the country. And so that will be free of cost. That will be free of cost. We have already put NCERT books available in digital format to anybody to publish themselves without any cost and spread the message of our knowledge in schools. So there is tremendous possibility and synergy between HRD ministry and IT ministry, where we will work together. I have the force, you have the wherewithal, and with both together, we can achieve the transformative idea of our Prime Minister Narendra Modi to make country a digital country and a digital governance is our dream. And
thank you, sir, for highlighting the between the two ministries and the various initiatives and measures which your ministry is taking. 3 days of our discussion said this is not these. The progressive views and invite our Honorable Minister Shri Ravi Shankar Prasadji for his way forward address.
My distinguished, enthusiastic colleague in the Council of Ministers, Prakash Javadekar, Minister for Human Resources, my distinguished Minister of State P.P. Chaudhary, Secretary Arna Sundarajan, Mr. Brian Edloff, Excellency Ambassador of Ireland, Mr. Barbosa, Head of the Union University, Thomas Janowski, we picked up good friendship, but you are leaving, something very surprising. Mr. Shigeru, ladies and gentlemen, at the very outset, let me congratulate my team of my department, led by the Secretary Arna Sundarajan, the NEGD and Radha Johan in particular, entire team, for doing this program in such a wonderful manner. Radha, where are you? Where are you, Radha? Okay, very good. I was a little worried. I'm a very amiable minister, but I'm a very hard taskmaster. I was told a big delegation was to come, delegates from 60 countries were to come. I was monitoring them, but not interfering, because I trust my people. And today, in such a flawless manner, this extraordinary ISCOF was organized. They deserve full appreciation from their minister. I'm very proud of them. Keep it up. Mr. Janowski, you rightly said ISCOF is not a conference simpliciter. It is a community. I think that is very appropriately described. And what was our initiative while holding this conference? We are living in a different world. Earlier, the real world used to dictate the virtual world. Now the virtual world dictates the real world. The problems arise in the virtual world to be addressed in the real world. That is what technology has brought about. And therefore, this virtual and the real will continue to have engagements. This virtual and the real will continue to have problems. And this can be addressed only by cooperation and collaboration. Therefore, I always feel very strongly that one is the theory of conferences like ISCOF. One is the practice. We in India always feel that we must translate the theory into practice and show how they are working for the community and the society. And today, Mr. Janowski, this whole insistence of bringing the common service centers as a part of this conference was my initiative. Because I wanted to show all of you as to how little girls coming from the poorest of the poor families, like farm laborers, can be made digitally empowered and see good light at the end of the tunnel. That is what digital technology is about. It empowers them. It awakens them. And I'm happy a lot of interactions have taken place here in the field of technology, in the field of education, in the field of health, in the field of good models of e-governance, and also the challenges which you have to face. In my opening address, I said something. And in this concluding remark, I said, right from the time, here for two things, to end discrimination, initiative which has got reflected in various ideologies, from Marxism to various forms of socialism, at times revolution, at times bloody, then a great message of ahimsa, non-violence, led by our great founding leader Mahatma Gandhi, and other initiatives. But why is digital ideology important? And I would like to elaborate it, and I have to appeal to the ISCOF community. My approach is, ladies and gentlemen, and this I am saying all, Prakash, Javadekar, myself have been activists from our student life. We have our baptism by fire. And what is important is, digital technology is creating equity without erecting ideological barriers. That's very important. You must understand that. And in India, where our Prime Minister sought to have this program of Digital India, it was basically a program to foster equity, to generate empowerment, to create awakening and above all make a better informed, empowered Indian. And what you saw today of the Common Service Center was a textbook case as to how my application of digital technology, you empowered those. They were forgotten, forlorn young girls in a remote village of India, completely accessible. But here came the mouse and the computer, which transcended the barriers of geography, of region, of caste and community, and gave them a hope that I see the biggest multiplier power of this technology, which ISCOV is seeking to promote. If this happened, good governance come as a consequence. I'm happy you have talked about Aadhaar, which I administer in my ministry. Now, if 1.12 billion Indian today are on Aadhaar, we linked up Aadhaar with mobile seeded to the bank account. Ladies and gentlemen, we have saved 50,000 crores, more than $8 billion, which used to be pocketed by middlemen or fictitious claimants. I think ISCOV, when you talk of electronic governance is designed to promote good governance, honest governance, accountable governance, transparent governance. I have to request one thing to you, why I briefly gave these indications. I would like ISCOV movement to study the Indian model. Give us suggestions to improve. But if you are doing something good, make a statement about it world over for replication. Then the world will come closer. Prakash was just talking about Swayam. You know, in our country, this digital education, we are promoting in such a big way, e-Pathshala, e-scholarship. We have got 10 million Indians on e-scholarship. At one click, they get their entire scholarship provisioning done. We have Wi-Fi hotspots in colleges, institutions, and a massive program. I talked about I don't know how many people doing PhD program? 3,000 provision government scholarship for PhD in electronics. We are promoting flexible electronics. We are promoting Internet of Things research. Therefore, from human research, human resources, to high-end research, to education, to digital kiosk working at the ground. This is how we are undertaking a holistic view of digital transformation of India. I think that is breaking the barriers of ideology. Therefore, this model as to how digital spread creates equity. Digital platform generates empowerment. Digital patronage, assistance, education creates awakening. And we have realized that too well. Therefore, we are going to scale up our digital literacy program in a massive way, going to make 60 million Indians digitally trained in the coming 3 years by digital literacy program at government cost. These are very important issues. I thought I must flag you. There is one last issue I would like to flag. I had a very wonderful discussion with Mr. Jonsky on the dinner table day before yesterday. I thought we'll continue our dialogue, but he's leaving the ISCOV movement. I hope not permanent. The use of data science. A company can say, I have so many customers. This is the profile of the customers. That is their data asset. But how they can value add that data to become a data product company. And then data analysis will become an area of big challenge. I'm very excited. We said in India we have got 1.08 billion mobile phones. This is a data. 350 million smartphones, it is a data. 112 billion Aadhaar, it is the data. But on the other side, there is equally an important issue. Data is mine. I am the individual. Why should my data be made public? In Aadhaar, we have given a parliamentary legislation whereby we have said we will maintain privacy, and our law is so tough that even I, as a minister of IT, cannot reveal my own fingerprint and icon, iris, except for the authorized objectives outlined in the Act. Otherwise, I suffer consequences, including prosecution. But if innovation has to grow, data has to grow. If digital spread has to come about, the data of the world will become and sanctity of data privacy. How do we respond to those two challenges which are competing, conflicting, but also exciting? I think this is an area where I would expect ISGOV to. What is the biggest asset of digital technology? They say, don't go into silos. You have to work together. Because sitting far away in a remote corner of India, I can talk to anyone on the Facebook sitting far away in Latin America at a click of a button. And no barrier can stop that. That is what internet has done. And I'm sure this is going to get replicated, going to become faster. And engaged human being of the world will collaborate themselves by force, exchange of ideas. In that light, how do we meet this challenge will always remain an issue. I can only tell you to the eyes, only think there is no problem. But if there is a problem, as the head of the department, I own up all. Changes. Therefore, the ISGOV must come. And some of the samplings you got in the cultural program, the Dances of India. These, in India, we are very proud of our plurality. We are very proud of our diversity. Because in spite of all the diversity and plurality, there is an abiding unity in India. And that spirit has endured us for the last more than 7,000 years of recorded history. And we are very proud of that. Drawing upon that heritage, empowered by the digital technology, we look forward to future with excitement. Thank you. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, sir, for your very thoughtful thoughts and your way forward address and remarks, which has actually set the tone and the context of our next ISGOV. Also thanking also Shri Prakash Javrekar ji had to leave for a pressing engagement, but thank you, sir, for joining us and sharing your views. So ladies and gentlemen, there was a question raised here that from here, where do we go as we continue to learn, continue to evolve and continue to contribute? So for that breaking news, I would like to invite His Excellency, Mr. Brian McElduff, the Honorable Ambassador of Ireland. Where do we go from here?
So the secret is out, because it's the Irish Ambassador who's speaking. Thank you very much. It's quite late in the day, so thank you for staying for this final part of the presentation. I'd like to congratulate the organizers and indeed the government of India on such a fantastic conference. I only saw and we're going to show you a video in a short amount of time. I've seen the video and I can recommend it. It tells you much more than I could ever say. I just really wanted to say a few words because it is late. Looking back maybe a little bit to September 2015, Prime Minister, it was very historic. It was the first Prime Minister's visit from India since Nehru's. Time. UN issues, especially on the old Millennium Development Goals and now the new SDGs. So I'm very pleased to tell you that next year's conference in Galway, in April 2018, I understand it will have a focus on the SDGs. Just to say a few words about how I spend my time as Irish ambassador in India. Education is the single really big thing we do, our really big success story. We've actually about 2,000 Indian students in Ireland, mostly at postgraduate level, quite a few in Galway, by the way. We hope the numbers will increase. We see Brexit as an opportunity. We're not happy about Brexit, and it's also a huge challenge for us, but we're fully committed to the EU. Of course, Ireland is an English-speaking country. We drive on the left. We enjoy Indian food. It makes a great deal of sense to come to Ireland to study. Another thing we do is we allow, and we're exceptional in this, we allow Indian students to stay on for 2 years after they graduate and get a very good job, including one of our social media companies. They're not ours. They're mostly American companies, of course. We are a huge center for the new media. Really, we are in a way for them. So Ireland is a great place for any to start their career, and for Ireland to follow India in hosting this particular prestigious event. Obviously, we're very different in scale, but we are both relatively young nation states, all of very ancient countries, and there's a reason why we're both very young nations. It's the same reason, of course. But we have very similar values when it comes to relate. ISCOV to Ireland next year. The Irish government itself is very committed to e-government, to open government, to positive reform and open data, and has done so for many years. Many of us have had to adjust as public servants to this new reality, helped by a very strong training program for public servants. So perhaps I should end there because I don't want to take away from the video you're going to see. I always feel at home in India because we have the same colors, green, white, and orange. It's also St. Patrick's Day next week, which is becoming a thing for you because I have a compatriot here, and I'm sure he, so on that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Excellency. So from here, from India, the baton gets passed to another leading economies of the world, and the dates are already out. You can mark your calendar. And towards this, as the dates are already out, we also have now the announcement of the PC chairs of ISGAV 2018. To make the announcement, I would like to once again invite here Ms. Elza.
Welcome to Galway, ISCOV delegates. Galway is really a wonderful city, and there's something for everybody in Galway. Galway is very fortunate that they're going to be the European Capital of Culture in 2020. It's going to allow Galway a wonderful opportunity to showcase all its cultures and the wonderful city and surrounds that we have here on the west coast of Ireland.
On behalf of you, welcome to ISCOV and to welcoming you to Galway to Ireland in 2018. Although India and Ireland are countries that are hugely different in scale and size, we share a young, growing population, understand the huge role that technology can play in improving public services and in changing the lives of our citizens.
Falchka Galyev, Oscar NUI Galyev. It's more Lord Umsa, Shansa, Behagam, Kula Fokler Olive, Egan O'Cod Shop. Welcome, ISCOV, to Galway and to NUI Galway. Our university has a long tradition in informatics. We want to advance that work through research, through teaching, and engaging with practitioners. We see this conference as a possibility and as an opportunity for all to come together from all countries, developing and developed, from government, from practice, from theory, from academia, working together to explore the issues around eGov and eGovernment. I look forward to welcoming you all to this university and to Galway. We have a tradition of welcoming colleagues from all over the world, international people, and we think that you will benefit and you will enjoy your time.
Have a wonderful time here in our city.
And we all, and the Irish government, look forward to seeing you come to Ireland next year and continue your important. Thank you.
So we are very excited to go to Galway. I think it's an excellent location. Delfinas University, the Open Governance in Guimarães, Portugal, and also she's a professor from Universidade do Minho in Portugal. And the third PC chair that is not here, but she was with us all these 3 days, is Dr. Atreji Kankahali from National University of Singapore in Singapore.
So I'm very confident that with the experience of our steering committee chairman, we can still rely on Tomas, I'm sure. He's stepping down but not moving off. And of course, the wonderful community, we are very sure that we'll be able to do something also nice, maybe different, maybe not in this scale, but in our own way, in the Irish way, right? So we very much look forward to doing that next year. Of things.
We conclude ISGOV 2017 to propose a final formal vote of thanks. I would like to request respected secretary, Ms. Aruna Sundaranjan, Secretary, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, to propose a formal vote of thanks.
The Chair of ISGOV 2017, Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, Honorable Minister of Electronics and IT. Guest of Honor, Sri Prakash Javadekar, Honorable Minister of Human Resource Development. Sri P.P. Chaudhary, Honorable Minister of State Electronics and IT. Knowledge partners from UN, UNESCO, and other institutions. Ambassador of Ireland, Tomas Janowski, founder of the ISGOV series, Mr. Shigeru, other dignitaries on the dais, participants, ladies and gentlemen. Over the last 3 days, we have seen political leaders, ministers, government officials, academicians, industry experts, civil society, technology leaders, and the practitioners of e-governance, like the CSC entrepreneurs, come together to deliberate on various challenges and opportunities in the theory and practice of e-governance. 12 extraordinary track sessions, 5 special events, 4 compelling keynote lectures, plenary discussions, and a rich poster exhibition presented a unique opportunity to the participants to discuss, share ideas, and reflect on key themes and aspects of digital government. ICEGOV 2017 also truly took the Digital India Agenda global. On the sidelines of ICEGOV 2017, we also celebrated the journey of digital champions and women empowerment through technology. As announced by the Honorable Minister, Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Ministry of Electronics and IT and the Government of India are committed to institutionalizing the spirit of ICEGOV, that is international collaboration and partnership, to enrich our understanding and to work collectively for implementing digital governance for the benefit of all. This conference began on a high note, and it is gratifying that it is ending on an equally high note. Few conferences manage to maintain the energy and momentum, but I think what is remarkable is that your presence indicates how this conference has been able to bring people and ideas together. And that, I think, is the true measure of its success. We saw an extraordinary dance performance, which had many diverse strands. And I think this ICEGOV Conference 2017 reflects a similar spirit, that while the agenda of digital government for the benefit of all. At the outset, let me place on record our deep gratitude to Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, Honorable Minister of Electronics and IT, for his outstanding support and leadership, which shaped ICEGOV 2017 right from the start. His inspirational and powerful address at the inaugural set the tone, and his equally inspiring address today leaves us with much room for thought. I want to express my gratitude to Sri Prakash Javdekar, Honorable Minister of Human Resource Development, for his gracious presence and his rousing words. I express my gratitude to Ms. Maria, Presidency and Administrative Modernization, who has been with us, who has been keenly engaging with us on this conference and has played an instrumental role in shaping it. I would like to express my thanks to the officials of the United Nations University, UNESCO, all the program chairs and juries who spent many painstaking hours going over the papers, selecting the papers and editing them for final presentation here. Naturally, no ICEGOV conference can start or indeed end without the contribution of Tomas Yanowski, ICEGOV series coordinator, Mr. Rahul Day, the program chair, and Ms. Rehema Baguma, the program chair. Thank you. An event of this magnitude requires meticulous planning. And while we all enjoyed the fruits of the hard work done by Radha, I am sure that Radha must have spent many sleepless nights. Thank you, Radha, and the entire team at NEGD, who have worked untiringly with passion for more than a year. Last but not least, you, the audience, have the print and the electronic media for their excellent coverage of ICEGOV 2017. If this conference established a definitive conclusion, it is that effective and sustainable e-governance is not a destination, but a continuously evolving process and a journey. I have pleasure in handing over the baton of the next lap of this journey to Ireland, who are hosting the 11th edition of ICEGOV in 2018. I am sure that Ireland and Galway will take forward the spirit of ICEGOV 2017, and we look forward keenly to an equally successful and impactful ICEGOV 2018. In closing, I want to mention that India will be hosting the Global Conference on Cyberspace, GCCS, towards the end of this year. I invite all of you, and therefore I will not say goodbye, but will say that I look forward to seeing all of you again. Namaskar, Jai Hind.
Thank you, ma'am. And with this, ladies and gentlemen, we close ICEGOV 2017. Thank you to all of you for your participation, and looking forward further as we move to Ireland from here. Thanking once again the Honorable Minister and all the other distinguished dignitaries. Thanking all of you.
Shape the future with us.